B-Pod Studios.
Now it's time for Zolak and Bertrand. Brought to you by BetMGM, the king of sportsbooks, on the Sports Hub.
Welcome into Zolak and Bertrand on this Wednesday from Radio Row in Las Vegas. We're presented by BetMGM, the king of sportsbooks, Beatle, Zoe, and Phil Perry today.
All right, Phil.
From Mandalay Bay Convention Center here in Vegas.
I had to show Phil how to turn his box on.
Yeah, it turns out there's a button right on the box.
It says power.
Mic on.
That's what it says.
Yeah, just completely overlooked that.
That is the button.
I'm learning every day.
Our coverage of Radio Row presented by Safety Insurance. How's everybody doing?
Doing good.
Good.
Hi, everybody.
Feeling good.
How you doing, Phil?
How are you doing, Beatle?
Great.
This is
fabulous.
This is usually the day where it sort of takes off for us.
Oh,
right?
It's starting to take off.
Slam, jam-packed show.
Oh, yeah. Engine's starting to rev up a little bit. We're going down the runway. Takeoff is imminent. That's what I would say.
It's a feel like being on the number one midday show in the country.
Hey, congratulations.
That's unbelievable. Thank you.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
Fantastic. Doesn't surprise me at all.
Thank you.
Feels like it's an annual tradition at this point. You guys do great work. You know that.
I give credit to T-Bone. They say, hey, it's the talent, but you got to prep the talent. And T-Bone and Tyler do a hell of a job.
They do?
Yeah.
All right.
Was that nice?
It was very nice.
Just
very nice.
T-Bone.
He thought it was appropriate.
He said, just think T-Bone.
Just
think. Tyler's tweeting some obscure.
What's he tweeting?
Some obscure minor leaguer he's excited about.
Well, that's his thing. He's got a thing. Let him do his thing.
I know.
All right, let's talk about what happened here on the airwaves yesterday afternoon
with
Michael Lombardi and Michael Felger.
That was something else.
It was fun, wasn't it? A lot of buzz from that thing that happened yesterday. And you know what it is? It's just add him to the list. I've been calling him a Bobo, the Belichick Bobo, for years.
That's a bit much.
Well, he is. It's what he is.
Yeah.
And add him to the list with all the friends of Bill, with Julian Edelman and Thomas Dimitroff, and now put Lombardi on the list. They just can't accept reality of what the hell went on the last couple of years. They just can't. They can't bring themselves to do it because they're too close to it, and they have a personal relationship and friendship with the guy. And that's okay.
Yeah.
That's okay. It makes them good friends. It's what I would do for my friends. If I had a friend for 25, 30 years, if that were one of my friends, I'd do the exact same thing that these guys do.
Sure.
But just everyone know what the hell that is. That's a guy sticking up for his friend. That's all it is. There's no basis in reality with all of the defenses that he offered yesterday. And apparently it's all Mac's fault. Why was it bad? Mac Jones. Same thing we heard at the press conference with, I think, Gerard Mayo. There were some, it feels like they're putting it all on Mac. That's what it feels like. They want to blame Mac for the problems.
Well, there are others who are certainly doing that, right? Julian Edelman, I think, is at the top of the list there. Hey, it's a quarterback league. I've heard Edelman say, I think, this past week, if you were to hire Bill Belichick as your head coach, though, your team would immediately be 35% better. Well, then why'd it go bad? Well, it's a quarterback league. Okay, so which one is it? Do you get immediately better by adding Bill Belichick, or is it all in the quarterback?
He's not saying with the talent Bill had. I think he's saying take Bill, put him on a different team where you got a quarterback, sort of an established guy, and he's going to make that team 35% better. There were tight games we lost this year, no doubt about it. And I think that's what Belichick and the Belichick buddies get buried in is – one play here, one play there, and that's the tough part because I never heard Bill talk that way. It's always been, it is what it is. You're in a situation you're in because you created it.
That's the league, though.
I know that. There's a lot of tight games that come down to the wire, and quarterbacks usually get you over in that fourth quarter. Look at this guy here, Patrick Mahomes, that we talk about. When Brock Purdy's bad, they lose. When Brock Purdy's pretty good and manages, that team wins. So there's some middle. The one thing you really don't hear, and I totally agree with them, like he's a great coach. He can still coach. I see him grinding. I know all that. I know he's won 6 Super Bowls. I think Lombardi mentioned it 15 times yesterday. We know that. I want to know what happened post-Brady and how did the personnel get so bad? Because this is about personnel. All they have to do is say he screwed up the personnel. That's on him. It's not about, well, it's a transition. Yeah, but
they won't even do that.
I know.
They won't even do that. You won't hear that from any of those guys we're talking about.
Bill Blue with the personnel.
Which is why it's just ridiculous to even consider that what they're saying is based in reality. Like, it's not. You guys say, so everything was fine. It was all the other stuff that has nothing to do with Bill, apparently.
And the argument yesterday, I mean, that thing devolved. Because he just kept coming back to, well, you think it was all Brady. You believe it was all Brady. When it's really not been the case. If you listen to those guys or you hear us talk here or you hear us on NBCSportsBoston.com, anybody would acknowledge that Bill Belichick did a great job when he had Tom Brady.
Absolutely.
And they needed Bill Belichick to win all those Super Bowls. He was a massive, massive part of it between what he did on the sidelines and what he did in the front office. But you can't erase what happened over the course of the last 4 years, really, as things started to trend downward and there's really no thorough, detailed explanation for it. I thought we might get a little something on ownership spending from Mike Lombardi, but he didn't really want to go there.
Like I said, he'd never been in a meeting with Jonathan Kraft or Robert Kraft.
That's what I wanted.
So he didn't know.
I wanted something along those lines.
But
he did say.
He brought up Lois.
He did.
Lois spent one bottom three.
One of the lowest spending teams in the league.
Yep.
Yep.
So that's there, and I think that's a little sliver into Bill's conscious, even though he made it very clear he's not speaking for Bill.
I took that as the way Bill brought it up, what, a year ago?
After the season.
Yeah.
After the 2022 season.
And I took that as him defending Bill, saying he can only shop for cheaper groceries. You know? Bargain now.
Spent a record amount in 2021. Didn't go so great, though.
Yeah. We know that.
So, are they going to be willing to change that now? Are they going to be willing to change that now with Bill Belichick gone? Is it as simple as that? You snap your fingers and say, well, Bill's out. Now they've got cash to burn. They've got cash to burn, and it's all of a sudden it's going to be a different approach. I think people in the building, Zoe, would tell you, and you've probably heard the same things. They were one and the same. They were simpatico, Robert Kraft and Bill Belichick, when it came to how the finances were handled.
Yeah.
Bill handled it a certain way. They were his decisions. But, you know, it worked for a long time for Robert Kraft's team, and so, you know, he's happy to sign off on that.
Sure.
Yeah.
Do you know the actual date that free agency kicks off? March 5th is the day you can tag people. That's when you can tag people. So I'm trying to think, like, okay, are they going to spend? What's going to be our first indicator? Maybe getting a Michael Wano contract done, something like that. I think that would get people feeling good around here. Good homegrown guy that can play, him or Duggar, get one of those type deals done. So I'm kind of leery on tagging the tight end now that it's 18.6. We screwed that number up a week ago.
March 13th.
March 13th. So this party begins March 13th.
Well, it actually will begin right before that, won't it? The actual contracts can't be signed until the 13th.
Yeah, you get your legal tampering period. Right.
Yeah, so you'll start hearing reports.
So that Friday before, right?
Yeah, right around there. Yeah. Right around there is when that all begins.
So they got 3 weeks and we're rolling, man. You got to get your ducks in line. You got to get a direction as to what you want to do. You better have your players circled.
I just didn't think that the defense of the last 4 years would have to involve, like, ignoring all the bad stuff. Like, this happened, guys. They were a four-win team. Did you see how bad it looked? And it's all because of Mac Jones? That's it? It's just Mac Jones?
No,
that's
the only... Cam Newton was here,
too. You can't tell me that it's just Mac Jones. They won 7 games with Cam Newton.
But they didn't ask him, which I was shocked at. Why did he go with Lombardi as offensive coordinator? Why did he go with Patricia as offensive coordinator? They didn't get into that, did they?
Well, Lombardi defended that, too.
Yeah, he defended that, and then again, put it on Mac Jones.
Everyone thought it was Matt Patricia's fault that the offense wasn't very good last year, and then this year they got worse. Billy O'Brien was supposed to fix it all.
He threw that on O'Brien. Like, so
No. That was his way of defending Bill O'Brien and Matt Patricia. Even with Bill O'Brien, it was even worse. Which tells you how bad it is, and it was Mac Jones. That's what he did.
Oh, okay.
He wasn't taking a shot at Billy.
I took that as, Billy didn't have a good year.
No, I don't think that's what he was saying at all. I think he was saying that it's Mac Jones.
Okay.
It's a quarterback league. All Mac's fault.
What makes it less acceptable of an explanation is the fact that he played pretty well as a rookie, right?
Yeah.
It wasn't like they just whiffed on the evaluation. This wasn't a Zach Wilson scenario where you've never seen him play good football. You've seen him play good football in an offensive huddle that was pretty devoid of high-end offensive talent as a rookie in 2021.
And then it went down by the time he got to year three. He had worse talent around him. Instead of building around him, instead of doing the right thing and helping the guy and putting talent around him, The roster got worse.
What's scary, though, like, even if you look at it in snapshots, like, those first two games to start the year this past year, I thought he came out ready to go. And I thought, I got excited about, you know, the diversity of the offense, the different motions they used. I mean, it was Philly and Miami to start the year. And you got the ball in your hands late, and you had the booty game where he didn't tap his toes. Like, you catch those, like, we're in this sucker. And Max moving around, making plays, the scramble drill where he hit Hunter Henry, it was a tight window he threw it into. I don't think he wants to do that all the time, but Hunter ends up catching that touchdown. He battled. He came out battling, and then things went south. And I don't know if he got so scarred from that Dallas game. That Dallas game was a bad game. Strip sack touchdown, pick six touchdown. You know,
it's all confidence.
Now all of a sudden it gets in your head. When you start getting pulled out of games, and then four times you get yanked out of games.
It's not that hard to trace the line from where he started, whether it's as a rookie, or even if you're talking about these first couple of games of the season this past season, to trace the line between Mac Jones and his confidence and why, maybe, it started to go south when it went south.
What about the Baltimore
offensive
game
line is a disaster. The receiver room is a mess. You're in your third offense in as many years. These are things that are controllable by the person who controls the football operation. So it's not that hard to trace that line. I know everybody wants to put it on Mac Jones, but the problems with this team go well beyond the quarterback position. They're going to find that out this offseason when they're trying to staff an entire offensive huddle. But Mike Lombardi didn't want to go there.
I mean,
yesterday.
They just talk to these people. Again, it's a whole group now. There's a whole party of them. And I would say, you're talking out of both sides of your mouth. Oh, you think it was all Brady? Oh, well, it's a quarterback league. Mac Jones sucks. So wait, let me get this straight. The quarterback can bury the head coach and be the fall guy, but when the quarterback is the best to ever play the position, it wasn't all him. It was coaching. Like, what are we doing here?
And he's closer to being right on the Brady thing. Right, he is closer to being right. It wasn't all Brady. It wasn't 100% Brady.
No.
But if you go the other way when it goes bad, I agree with you. It's inconsistent. That's all it is.
Yeah.
It's inconsistent because your friendship with the guy, which he's very open about, colors your commentary. And so we all know that going in. It's what makes for a good fight.
Yeah, I'm not going to tell you Mac Jones wasn't a problem and is a problem for the team. And he wasn't horrible because he was. It's obvious. But now that has nothing. Now coaching has nothing to do with it.
And
I would agree with you.
Too.
It wasn't all Brady. What are you, crazy?
Yeah. So they had good defenses. They had Gronkowski.
They had good coaching. They had good game plans. They had all of that. And they also had the greatest quarterback ever.
You had toughness.
Which is a big part of that.
You had toughness on offense. You could run the ball when you wanted to. You had a fullback in James Devlin who would knock your head off. You had backs at
You had great hard. Rosters. You had great roster management. You had great personnel moves.
Like even Rex Burkhead was a freaking backup running back. Like, and he ran hard in his playoff games. But even back to Mac here, I've talked to people about this too, the injury. That injury to that ankle against Baltimore and sort of how everything happened after that, you know, the handling of that Monday, that weird Monday night game, didn't know who was starting and you were going to start, you yanked him. And
that's stadium's chanting for his backup.
Yeah.
I didn't think he could ever, and I don't think he came back from that. I didn't think he could ever come back from that type of moment because, man, you don't forget that. Remember how pissed Jacoby Myers was after that? I can't believe we did that to him.
He's still pissed, by the way. We talked to him over for the next Pats podcast. He is still he gets downtrodden when Mac Jones gets brought up.
Wow.
Like, genuinely sad.
It's this guy.
To see how it's unfolded for him. And there's a part of Myers that believes, had he remained in New England, that it wouldn't have gotten that bad for a guy that he knows works hard, for a guy that he has a really good relationship with.
They had a good rapport with each other. They really did.
Other Patriots items include Ben McAdoo now being hired as a senior offensive assistant. We'll get to that. A trade proposal for the Pats, an idea to land the best receiver in the sport. Yes,
they also
a way
just,
to do that.
Also just what? Hired a quarterbacks coach.
Who did?
Patriots.
The New England Patriots hired a quarterbacks coach?
They did. T.C. McCartney.
And his name?
Who?
T.C.
Who is it?
T.C. McCartney is his name.
What do we know about him?
He's with the Browns. It looks like a Van Pelt hire.
Okay, Van Pelt.
Van
Pelt's buddy.
Okay, yeah.
tight ends coach for Cleveland.
And now he will be the quarterbacks coach. Isn't that going in the wrong direction?
That'd be the last
thing. Do you want to go from tight ends to quarterbacks in this league right now?
Yes.
The best quarterback coach at
tight ends is such a coveted thing now. Like, is the path to being the OC, isn't it?
Quarterbacks.
Oh my God, Jake.
Quarterbacks is the primary. You want to be quarterbacks coach, then OC.
Okay, so
that's usually the path.
That's our new. That's our progression right now.
Yeah, the McVay progression's a little different.
Okay. All right.
He was tight ends, then OC.
Okay.
Yeah, oftentimes it's quarterback.
All right. 617-779-0985. This hour of coverage brought to you by Fan Funded. Jake in Boston is here.
Oh, boy.
We'll get to that in a moment as well.
It's a cute jacket, Jake.
All right. Don't go anywhere. Zolak and Bertrand live from Radio Row in Vegas.
Mike Bertrand, Scott Zolak, live from Radio Row at the Mandalay Bay Hotel in Las Vegas. Presented by Safety Insurance on 98.5 The Sports Hub.
Phil, what do you think? Do you buy what Bedard is selling, that McAdoo's a good talent evaluator, in particular quarterbacks? Like, is that an area that he could help this team really decide what they should do with that number three overall pick and then help develop those quarterbacks once they have them on the roster?
Yeah, I think so. I think that's why, you know, that's why you make this hire, quite frankly. Of course, he has some head coaching experience, and so if Gerard Mayo needs some help with things that he's never seen before in that role, maybe he can help him in that regard. But I think this stuff that we're talking about now, the quarterback evaluation, the coaching up of whatever quarterback comes next, is even more important. Not only is he apparently a great evaluator of quarterbacks, you know, go back to the 2018 draft class, he had Josh Allen and Lamar Jackson supposedly at the top of his list of quarterbacks that he would want to work with, and that was a class that we all thought was loaded with quarterback talent that ended up being very spotty outside of Allen and Jackson. But he worked with Aaron Rodgers, he's worked with some really talented people over the course of time, and he's not ancient. He's 46 years old, so he's done a lot in a pretty short period of time. You got that James Dean stick dream. Look in your eye, and I got that red lip classic thing that you like. And when we go crashing down, we come back. It's Phil Perry with Trenny.
Our Bella Early Edition, was that last night?
That was last night.
You want to expand on that?
Right here
all?
On Radio Row.
You got any more to say about that? What else did you say
about
that?
I think that's why Ben McAdoo is so highly valued, right? He has this variety of offensive experience in the league, coached a bunch of different positions on that side of the ball.
Yep.
But what he will be able to contribute when it comes to shaping the next quarterback will be the ultimate value that he can bring to the franchise. That's the one thing they have to get right now. And maybe they punt on it, maybe they wait, maybe it's not till 2025 that they really invest in that position. I hope that's not the case for our sake.
Yep.
Be much better for us if they invest there now. But that's why you're here. It's be offensive spackle, work with the tight ends if you need to, work with the line if you need to. But let's make sure we surround this quarterback with the right people. Mac Jones is a cautionary tale. They didn't do that with him. Now he's broken. So whoever comes in here next, he's got to have the right coaching. He's got to have somebody with a lot of experience on that side of the ball to help him through whatever adversity he's going to face, inevitable adversity that he's going to face. So that's the part of the McAdoo hire that I like. I don't know if I love him being the assistant head coach or whatever was rumored to be his title, because he wasn't all that successful in that role.
Be careful.
But as an offensive mind, I think he could help.
Be careful with coaches that, hey, I coach a certain position. Like Charlie Weiss coached a lot of positions for us. He was really good at every one. You know, he had Ben Coates. He had Curtis Smart. Like, when you have good players, it's going to make you a good coach too. But it's also, you got to make sure you got the right guy when you got a young guy in there, to what sort of Phil's talking about. Yep. I don't want this to be an experimental thing where a guy only worked with tight ends. Now it's my first time working with quarterbacks, and he's reading some quarterback manual that I need to do this. That's the nice thing about guys that played the position is I know what your feet should be. I know where your eyes should be on this one. I know how we should be reading coverage here. See, he's going to be able to do that type of stuff, but the fact you have McAdoo there helps a lot because he's a good quarterback evaluator. He's going to understand, hey, this is what the problem is with the offense. So we'll see. We'll see how this all goes, but it's a little bit new. A little bit new for
me. A little new, but you have two guys there now between Van Pelt and McAdoo who have a long track record, of coaching that position.
It's got to be better than Joe Judge.
Light years.
Yes.
Yeah. Light years.
Yeah. Hey, just looking into T.C. McCartney.
Yes.
He's worked a lot with Kyle Shanahan.
There you go.
He was with Shanahan in 2014 when he was with the Browns, and then he went to San Francisco in 2017 and 2018 as an offensive assistant under Kyle Shanahan.
Okay.
So he's had multiple years there, and then he was an offensive assistant in Cleveland for a couple of years before becoming the tight ends coach. He did serve as the quarterback's coach of the Broncos back in 2019.
Yeah, I just have been texting back and forth with one of McCartney's former coworkers. Sounds like that Shanahan background is really his thing. And he knows Van Pelt's system, too. He spent 4 years with Van Pelt, so there's obviously a good relationship there.
A good blend here.
Yes.
For this individual.
I think this is a good sign, right, between the West Coast stuff that we already knew Van Pelt and McAdoo had.
Right.
Now to have McCartney in here as well, to have that Shanahan background, I think what you're going to see is a lot of under center, play action shots down the field, get it out of the quarterback's hands quickly. This is a quarterback-friendly, some would say quarterback-proof kind of scheme that has propped up guys like Jimmy Garoppolo in the past, made Matt Schaub look like a Pro Bowler back in the day when he was playing under Kyle Shanahan. This offense has taken average quarterbacks, made them good. It's taken good quarterbacks and at times made them great. Matt Ryan was an MVP in this offense.
When Brock Purdy's playing in the Super Bowl.
Exactly. Aaron Rodgers went from very good to MVP back-to-back years with Matt LaFleur. So this is going to be able to be very helpful, I would think, with whatever quarterback you bring in here, whether it's a rookie or a vet.
We have great sunglasses we're all wearing. Oh, you don't have yours on, Zoe.
Well, I packed them
you
back
put
up.
Them back in the box?
I didn't know that he was giving them to us.
Oh, Phil and I are both.
They're nice guys.
We're wearing them, man. Yeah. You swing sunglasses. These are badass. They weigh nothing at all.
Yeah, I feel like there's nothing on my face.
It's great. They don't weigh anything.
This is the kind of thing that happens only during Super Bowl week.
Oh, yeah. Jake in Boston comes through with his amazing Taylor Swift getup and says, here, have some sunglasses. Okay. Super Bowl week. It's on. It's on.
That man was bedazzled.
It's incredible. The entire thing. Come one more time for the cameras.
He flies out of the country.
He wears dark sunglasses.
That's right. He wears dark sunglasses.
Can the camera? Do the cameras even pick these up? I wonder.
Capella, bring the chair over.
Goodness gracious,
Sit
Jake.
He wears dark sunglasses and asked us to blur out his face.
A chair over.
Here. Take a headset. Put a headset on. Yep. It's like calling in.
What's up, boys?
Jake in Boston.
There he is.
Here at the Super Bowl.
This is great.
How are you doing?
I'm doing fantastic. Here. I would be remiss not to mention these are U-Swing
sunglasses. We just did. Mark, we just talked about it. We talked about how great
they
are.
From back there.
There you go, buddy. I'm sorry.
Couldn't U-Swing. Hear from back there.
Gorgeous.
Thank you, Jake.
So it's like actually being on remote with us now.
Is this custom? Did you get that custom made, this jacket?
I did. Mel the Clothing, who is actually designed, she's Boston based, so she designed clothes for Brittany Mahomes. And their two kids.
God.
Right after the AFC Championship game, I had a mutual friend with her, so I got in touch. I was like, I got to do something for Super Bowl. Because I've got to trigger a lot of the dads, Brads, and Chads that are going to be here.
Dads, Brads, and Chads.
There's no better place. Yeah, that was from the Time article. But there's no better place to do that than Radio Row. So everyone's here.
Yeah.
But, you know, walking in, all the hospitality people are like, oh, I like your jacket. Like, Moose Johnson bumped into me in the hall. Was like, my daughter wants a picture of that. So, you know, it's a statement piece. And then,
without a doubt.
And then Sunday or the weekend with some of the plans that are going on behind the scenes that I've got announcing today. It's not my announcement. It's the TikTok creator we've hired announcement. Taking a TikTok creator to the Super Bowl that's going mega viral right now.
Are you going to the game?
I'm going to the game.
Yes. Are you going to wear this to the game?
I will wear this to the game. And now,
if you don't get on TV, I think that'll be a big disappointment.
The problem is that the promotion I put together for the weekend needs the 49ers to win.
Yeah.
Oh,
go 49ers.
It's absolutely critical that the 49ers win.
So what are you going to do? You're going to root for the 49ers? Even though you go to the game in the Taylor Swift City Chiefs jacket?
My goal on Sunday is to win TikTok.
Win TikTok.
Which means I need the 49ers to win because I'm in on a storyline there.
Wow.
I'm floored.
That's disappointing.
When negotiating with this talent, I was very, very nervous over the course of the week. Like, am I going to lose this? Like, you know, am I going to lose it? Am
it's
I going to lose
clock.
This? But anyways, Sunday, pay attention. Certain quarterback and a certain storyline that I've got going on Sunday.
Okay.
All right.
All right.
That's some sunglasses, buddy.
Absolutely.
Big league tees.
Appreciate
Big
you,
league
Jake.
Tees.
Have a good week.
What a jacket.
Yep.
The headlines.
Outstanding.
Headlines now with Phil Perry. We've got more from Radio Row, including the 11 o'clock hour, which is one guest after another. Starting at 11.
That's the best guest of the week right there.
Starting at 11 a.m., 11:20, actually. We've got a long line of guests that will flow through for the rest of the day.
Great guests. Right
Cam Newton just walked through, by the way. Just saw him. Zoe talked to him. Phil talked to Cam Newton.
Big as hell, man.
Boy. Oh, he is a specimen. He is just unbelievable.
Seeing him in pads, it's nothing like I've ever seen. Like, when he was at Carolina and he was, like, ripped to...
Just impressive.
Ripped to shreds. Like, it's Superman. Superman in tights.
Well, and then you throw the hat on top of it. The guy looks like he's about 6 foot seven.
Yeah.
Well... Yeah.
He's 6'5", yeah.
He told us he's overweight right now. I'm like, nope. I think that as a guy who's not playing in the NFL anymore, you look damn good.
Looks like an athlete. Play.
Yes. Yep. We've got more to come from Radio Row. This hour of coverage brought to you by Fan Funded.
The best coverage from Radio Row Week. You can bet on it. It's Zolak and Bertrand, live from the Mandalay Bay Hotel in Las Vegas, presented by Safety Insurance on 98.5 The Sports Hub.
New England's got the number 3 pick. What does New England desperately need? A playmaker. Justin Jefferson, switch picks. I'll give you next year's number 1 and Justin Jefferson to go from 11 to 3. Because they've already got Jordan Addison. They got the tight end they like. They've got skill players.
Next year's 1?
And Justin Jefferson to move up to the number 3 spot to get your quarterback.
I mean, Justin Jefferson is, like, electric.
I'm not denying that, but you're not going to move up without giving up something.
You know what that feels like? Remember when Randy Moss ran to the Raiders and just did nothing and hated it?
I'm telling you right now.
He would hate
New England
Patriots.
Can't just... New England needs offense. Now, if I'm Gerard Mayo, I'd have no problem saying, I'll go back to 11. I'll have Mac Jones. By the way.
You'll have Mac... What? Mac Jones?
There'll be a quarterback available at 11. So you can... If you don't view... If you think Caleb's the dominant one, and then you don't have a big gap between everybody else, so what do I care if I go 3 to 11 if I get Justin Jefferson?
Minnesota Vikings reportedly looking to make a move, want to get in the game for a quarterback in this 2024 NFL draft, and the Patriots hold the number 3 pick, Colin Cowherd, suggesting the Patriots could swing a deal that would net them more draft capital and also get them Justin Jefferson.
I mean, I love it.
I absolutely love it.
Are you kidding?
It's the home run of all home runs.
Okay, but let me give his scenario that he just gave. You can get Justin Jefferson. You still get a good first-round pick, not what you have now.
Middle of the first.
You don't get the quarterback in this draft. You go to middle of the first.
Quarterback sitting there.
You get an additional one in there. Is that what he suggested?
For next year, maybe?
Yeah, for next year, right? So you're loaded up for next year. And as part of this, though, and we play this fantasy game, you have to accept Mac Jones as the Patriots quarterback in 2024. Do you do it?
No. Well, listen. Why do you have to accept that? I just don't.
We're playing a game.
Okay.
But if you're in the middle of the first round,
so you're building the rest of your roster.
J.J. McCarthy.
And with that draft pick, you're taking a tackle.
Okay.
So you've got a tackle, which, again, I don't love, but you get a tackle in the first round, and you get Justin Jefferson. But you've got to make do at quarterback with Mac Jones for a year.
Why does it have to be Mac Jones?
Because we're playing a game.
Okay, to play the game.
Right. Yeah, to play the game.
I'll play the game.
Just for a game.
Yes. Give it to me.
Yeah.
Yes.
I would
for the year. Yes.
I would do it.
Because he's getting his.
Mac is getting his.
You know what's kicked in too much here, and all the blame's going to him. And you're right. That's too much on him. You need help. The kid needs help.
But you're right. You don't have to accept that. There are other alternatives.
The other option, though, is take a quarterback that you may not love at 3, then not have another pick in the first round. So you got one player in that first round, and it might not be the quarterback you love.
Gardner Minshew, New England Patriot.
I'm lukewarm to that idea. Can I give you another option?
All right, come on. Let's get options. Come on, Zoe. Give me a name.
We haven't even talked about the third round pick yet. I think Justin Fields. Could be available to you.
Oh, the third round pick.
I get excited.
So that's a top of the third round pick to Chicago for Justin Fields. Now you've got Justin Jefferson, your tackle, and Justin Fields.
I think so.
I've not crapped on Justin Fields.
And I cut off your point too, so I'm sorry.
Oh no,
I cut you off.
No, but like,
I'm sorry.
So if you're stuck with Drake May at third, you know, number 3, you get nothing else the rest of the first round. You're talking about not getting Marvin Harrison, but getting a big time receiver with the trade.
Yeah.
you're going to get their pick in the middle of the first round where you could take a tackle. There's nine tackles are there.
Yep.
And go get Justin Fields for a third. That's the ultimate scenario for me right there.
And if you want to just stick with that original game where you're talking about Mac Jones, I would say this
Jones. Real quick, who's the other good receiver? Addison?
So Malik Nabers is near the top of the draft. He's the kid out of LSU. So, you know, if you watch a lot of Jaden Daniels, you saw a lot of Malik Nabers, very explosive, in and out of his cuts.
From Minnesota receiver.
Oh, yes. Addison? So he's a second-year player. He had a very good rookie year. Yeah. Okay. Jordan Addison out of USC.
But, like, if we're going to be down that road there, like, okay, we're not a contender, but you bring in, like, Justin Jefferson, he's going to be happy. We're going to have to pay him a ton. The other kid, you're going to have more control over.
They won't give him to you.
Yeah.
Because that's the thing. If Minnesota views this as a rebuild.
I'm trying to build my team, though, but I'm trying to.
But they're building, too.
Okay, good.
Right?
All right.
So
give me Jefferson.
Is Justin Jefferson going to be happy in Minnesota? He's going to be the same, right?
Yeah.
I mean, what's the quarterback situation in Minnesota? It's really not all that different from what it is here in New England. They don't have one either.
You don't know, right?
You don't know. And so I would just say that if you make that trade, you're paying him $20 million this year, and you have the right to tag him next year and force him to stay and say, well, you know, you're tagged, and we'll just tag you and force him into, you know, staying or signing him long-term with
a big, fat
contract. Yeah, that would be the goal, is that you're going to pay him at some point.
You're giving him the Tyreek Hill contract probably eventually something thereabouts.
But you've got leverage over him to get him, right? How would they land him as a free agent? They wouldn't.
Exactly.
So if you have him in your building for 2 years, you pay him a lot of money over the next 2 years, and the whole time you're saying, sign this big long-term deal with all kinds of guaranteed money. Right? I've got news for the Patriots. They're no different than any other team in the league now, which means you've just got to pay players, especially premium ones and stars, like every other team does. So you've got to say to one of the best receivers in the game, we'll pay you as the best receiver in the game. We'll give you that big, giant contract that you would get in free agency because we want you to be a Patriot and because we have no marketable stars on this roster. We don't have a single guy that creates buzz or excitement about this team. And right now, because we're a four-win team and we've got to keep our fan base happy and our clients happy, we're bringing you in and we're paying you because the people will come to the stadium to see Justin Jefferson.
No doubt. And that would have huge value. And if you don't end up loving the quarterbacks at the top of this draft, then that's the route you take. Yes. Okay, we didn't get the quarterback, but look at this guy.
Every kid would go out and buy the jersey on day one.
Tomorrow. Yep.
They'd be lining up at the pro shop in the parking lot in Foxborough to buy the guy's jersey. And that's not the reason why you should do it. The reason why you should do it is you desperately need talent. And I would be all in on this. If you're trading out of three, there are very few scenarios where I'd be, as just a fan, happy about doing that. If it lands you Justin Jefferson, well, okay, I see what you're doing here.
Matt Slater's gone too.
If I want to play devil's advocate for a less sexy scenario, and I don't want to, but the pushback would be this draft and most drafts now are so loaded at receiver. It's such a deep position every single year. We just don't realize it here locally in New England because they never find one, hardly.
Yeah.
Is it worth paying a guy that kind of money at a position that seems to be available to you at a very low cost every single year? That's the one small pushback I might have is you're probably not going to find Justin Jefferson, but you could find something pretty damn close for about a tenth of the cost in the draft.
Mm-hmm.
So, listen, I like the Justin Jefferson scenario.
I'll take the guy who's a known commodity.
All right.
Like,
you need a superstar. Like, we keep saying Bill Belichick was the team superstar. That's who you put
You don't have to scout Justin Jefferson. You know. Right?
Yeah,
you don't have to worry.
Nervous.
There's nothing that's going to keep you up at night about, is Justin Jefferson going to be a great player? You know, because you can have that with anybody you draft, including Marvin Harrison Jr.
We're scarred, though. We are scarred here in New England having watched bad receiver play for so long. It's not, generally speaking, other parts of the league, they find guys. So they have experience having found guys in the draft that work out and end up being stars.
Yeah, this team sucks
at
it.
They have for a long time.
And there are guys that are running the show that were employed here when they took N'Keal Harry, okay?
Fair.
So I don't have to trust any of them.
Fair.
I know they want to blame Bill for that, but we don't have to trust any of them. You guys took N'Keal Harry. You were in the room when that pick was submitted. You're all guilty. Guilty by association. You worked in the front office. You were scouting. You were in charge of that process. Nope. I don't care that Bill overruled you, allegedly. You're all guilty. You were all there for it.
I don't think Elliot Wolf was.
Oh, was Macro in there taking Tyquan Thornton? Because I've heard him talk about Tyquan Thornton like he's good. He isn't.
He was. Yeah.
Thank you. Let's get to your calls coming up next, because the 11 o'clock hour is loaded with guests. Tom Pelissero is going to join us. Rich Gannon's going to join us. We got a quarterback back-to-back thing happening with Rich Gannon and Jake Plummer. So
we've
got, yeah, we've got some quarterback talk coming up in the 11 o'clock hour here on Zolak and Bertrand. This hour of coverage brought to you by Fan Funded.
Live from the Mandalay Bay Hotel in Las Vegas, it's Zolak and Bertrand, presented by Safety Insurance on 98.5 The Sports Hub.
It's going to be a great halftime.
Well, it sure will.
Hit after hit after hit.
Hit parade, my friend.
He's not going to shove anything new down your throat.
Nope.
No. No shot.
No shot of that. He's going to play the hits.
No need.
Do the dancing and pop it and moonwalk.
Play the hits.
Like that's right in our wheelhouse, Beatle.
What's that?
Our era. When we were in college,
yesterday,
high school.
I was telling Holly that. I'm like, for our age group, Phil and I are the same age. Every high school thing, every college party, you heard an Usher song.
For about a decade.
Yeah. Yep.
Legend.
Legend. Oh, God bless. You okay?
Yeah, wow. We got water.
No, we don't.
Big guy, you make that run, please? Thank you.
That's our water intern, our one-week intern, Jake.
Jake's doing a great job.
Wow. Yeah. Thank you, Dennis.
Oh, look at that. Jake's doing a hell of a job.
Bonus points for you.
We told him he should get some credit for this at school.
What's the problem? Where'd that water come from?
Oh, all right. Now let's grab some calls. What do you say? Joey in Weymouth. What's up, Joey?
Not much. Thanks for taking my call.
Jake.
So I still have, you know, fans coming up to me talking, defending Bill, and acting like it's everyone else's fault but his. Only person to blame is Bill Belichick for what happened to him. Specifically when he got Patricia and Judge in. Those are two guys that were disgraced as head coaches, and their players wanted them gone. So when that happened, that's when everything changed for Bill. Because the first two seasons after Brady left, those were fine. He was fine then. But then that 2021 into 2022 season, that didn't mean. Because then the toxicity began, and the communication skills went down. And that's when you start to realize, all right, Bill Belichick can't adapt. He's just going to stick to what he knows. He ruined the team. He ruined the team. He ruined Mac Jones. And those are things that could be put on him. You can't go everywhere else blaming other areas. It's
right. All true. You can't just blame everybody else.
Not when you're the guy. Not when the setup is what the setup has been for the better part of the last 20 years.
Yeah.
You are making every decision. It all flows through you. And so maybe in his private moments he's accountable. Maybe with Mike Lombardi he's accountable for that. But it does feel like there's a lot that's gone on to one person in the quarterback, who it's easy to say now they missed on. It's easy to say he's not good enough now. But boy, there, I don't know what kind of quarterback would be able to survive a situation like the one that the Patriots have had offensively the last few years.
I would say it'd be very toxic for him.
Three offenses in 3 years, no line, no receivers. I mean, it's not, and certainly for a guy who doesn't have the physical skill set that's top tier in the league, right? If you're talking about a physical freak who can carry the team on his shoulders, the way, honestly, Justin Fields had to the first couple of years of his career, if you have that kind of guy, maybe you can get away with some missteps elsewhere. You couldn't do that with Mac Jones.
Fields might be the guy.
Am I talking you into it?
By that trade. No, Felger Mazron is too.
Third round pick?
Yeah.
That's not
much. Give up for him. I'd give up a third for him. And a second.
It's only 1 year left on his contract, but if he's good,
but
who cares?
But it's like
figure it out. Moving forward.
Why is Chicago so out on him?
Because they have the number one overall pick.
And is that the only reason?
Well, and he's about to get expensive. Fields is about to get expensive if you do want to keep him.
But he'd be the perfect stopgap guy if you could get him, draft a guy, develop him, and then make the decision in a year. Either you got to pay Fields. Hey, if he's good, then pay him. Or just franchise him for 1 year.
They could do that.
A six-year contract.
You could hold on to him and just say, Caleb Williams, you're going to sit on the bench. We really love you. That's why we took you number one overall.
Number one pick, you gotta play him.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. You could draft a quarterback and still play Justin Fields.
One overall, it's. I think it's hard not to play that guy.
I hear you.
You've got to have real stones as an organization to do
that. It's been Caleb Williams for 2 years. We've been talking about the guy. They got to play him. It's Chicago. Yeah, you got to play him.
All right. Rob is in Ohio. What's up, Rob?
Big Rob.
Hey, I'm Big Rob. Yeah. Hey, thanks for taking my call. I'm enjoying Vegas.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
It's Wednesday.
Vegas, so.
Okay.
Hey,
we're in Ohio. Big Rob in Ohio, right?
Yes, sir. From Somerset, Mass.
Okay. Anyway, all right.
Hey, I think the more we learn about Bill Belichick and history goes on here, I'm going to say it. The reason why the Patriots are so successful was Tom Brady. Period.
And I think that's it. Did Bill have nothing to do with it?
I think he was the coach. He's a good coach.
Okay, so he's a good coach, and Tom Brady was great. Fine. That's what you believe. At least you believe he's a good coach. At least you believe that.
Which is underselling it.
Yeah, of course it is.
He was a great coach for the vast majority of his tenure here. And I think things got a little sideways on him. And a lot of it is personnel-wise. I push back on some of the people who say it was only personnel. That he's still the best coach in the league and it's not even close.
Yeah, I don't
because
buy that.
I look at the coaching that we've seen and the lack of development and some of the in-game decisions and the lack of aggressiveness and some of the bad penalties and timeout usage, et cetera, et cetera. I think he slipped a little bit in that regard, too. It's not just the personnel. It's not just the personnel.
I think it's unfortunate for him that all this success coincides with Brady. I mean, it does stink for his sort of, as Felger kept telling Michael Lombardi, scoreboard. The scoreboard is what it is. Without Brady, his level of success is not great. And so I think it's okay to say this guy was great for two decades, and the last few years were bad, and he was bad at his job. It's okay to admit that. Like, it's okay to say he was the best there ever was for 20 freaking years. But everybody has their run of success come to an end. In pretty much anything you do, at some point, it might just not go well for you. And it didn't go well for him for several years at the end of his time here.
His prime coincided with Brady's, right? So it's a timing thing in a lot of ways.
Yes.
But he also helped develop Tom Brady. I mean, we know all the stories, and we know how much he did for this team to get the young quarterback going and to have them be such a winning franchise so early in his tenure as head coach here. So don't take anything away from him from that run. But it is fair for us to look at the last few years and point out everywhere it went wrong, because it wasn't just one decision with the quarterback in 2021.
But those guys can't do it. Lombardi can't do it. Dimitrov can't do it. Apparently Edelman can't do it. These guys are just blinded by the fact that they love Bill, which, I get it, you have a personal relationship and you got a friend, you're going to stick up for your friend.
I'm just remembering now, too, but the one thing that bothered me most about the Mike Lombardi interview yesterday was the indication, the implication that Bill wasn't, he didn't really draft Mac from the beginning or something along those lines. I think he knew a lot of people in the building like Mac Jones. Well, yes, they liked him well enough, and even Bill wasn't fully sold on him. I know that. But they were all sold enough that he was good enough to take at that spot. And they were so desperate for a quarterback because they had no Tom Brady plan, or post-Tom Brady plan, I should say, that he drafted Mac Jones. Don't tell us that it really wasn't his call, that it was everybody else in the building who liked him and who wanted him. That's revisionist history. He was on with it. He was in on the decision, as was Dave Ziegler, as was Elliott Wolff, as was Matt Groh. They were all for that decision. In real time.
Headlines, 90 seconds, and we will return our coverage from Radio Row, presented by Safety Insurance.